Thatcher with us for another episode of Retro Ice Time. This one a little unusual. For today's show, we'll not be seeing performances from one event alone, but rather I've had a blast picking out some of the significant moments from women's champions back in the 70s and 80s. They are fabulous. Although we don't have the full event to back them up, I still thought it was important for us to have a peek at individual performances to see where women's skating was nearly three decades ago. One person who was clearly on the inside was a longtime promoter of skating who also had a rather unique perspective. When Johnny Esau began covering skating, it was back in the mid-1950s when the now-defunct North American Championships were being held in Regina. We're not even talking television here. It was on radio when CFSA director Bert Penfold bugged Johnny to cover the event. When Esau witnessed the abilities of Defoe and Bowden, Tenley Albright, Carol Heiss, and the Jenkins brothers, he was sold and began what became a lifelong advocacy for skating and skaters. When he finally moved into TV sports production, he brought his interest and marketing abilities to all of Canada with the formation of the CTV network, and in 1962, in collaboration with ABC's Wide World of Sports, watched Canada bring home two world gold medals from Prague.
Well, we were fortunate that I had Wide World of Sports, and so I had all of that stuff, which we would not otherwise have had. We couldn't afford it. We couldn't have gone over there. We couldn't have had the feed. We couldn't have done any of that. But Wide World of Sports fed it to us, and of course, with Canada having such a great competition, it spread across the country, and suddenly skating caught on. And right after that, John Bassett asked me, he said, okay, now, what are the things you're going to do for this sports stuff you're doing on my station? And I said, well, the first thing we're really going to do is figure skating. He said, you mean that fancy skating stuff? I said, no, figure skating. And he said, well, okay, I guess go ahead. And I then got to the Canadian, the rights. I bought the rights to the Canadian championship. Didn't pay very much for them. I don't recall what the figure was. But in 1963, we went to Edmonton, did the Canadian championships, and then 64, and then 65. And the Canadian championships were catching on.
What have been some of your favorite moments in skating?
Well, it's a toss-up as to which would be number one. And that would be either Karen Magnuson winning in Bratislava in 1973, after having won in Canada in 1972, and then she went to Bratislava, and you'll remember the
whole Janet Lynn.
Janet thing. Lynn, and Karen was skating first, Janet Lynn was skating last, and the timing was such that we had a two-hour block on the satellite. And with Karen skating first and Janet skating last, we could just make the two of them. As it turned out, one skater dropped out. Karen had to skate earlier. We were going to lose her. So we got the satellite adjusted at the beginning, got Karen on, and then we couldn't tell whether she won it or lost it till Janet had skated as the very last skater. So I had Ollie Babarad and Otto Jelinek rush out onto the ice and pay off the Zamboni driver, and the people who were fixing little chips on the ice, slow down, and he's paying him to slow down because we're trying to kill time. Now it looks like we're going too long and we're going to miss Janet at the end because I lost my satellite to ABC at exactly 11 o'clock. Now they have to go out and tell them, hurry up, get this ice done. Now, these poor Czechoslovakian people figured you Canadians are crazy. But they did it, and just as Janet Lynn skated, we finally got the numbers.
Well, because this was before computers, too, so everything was being figured out by hand.
Oh, yeah, Billy Mitchell and all those ladies from the Canadian figure skating were sitting behind us, adding and subtracting and figuring the ordinals and so on. And they said, at the last moment, just as I was signing off with the credits, Janet Lynn loses, Karen Magnuson is the new world champion. And that, now when you take that and you try to compare that to 1988, you go all the way from 73 to 88, when a lot of things had happened in between, but the 88 Olympics in Calgary, and Liz Manley put on such a show. She, you know, she had to beat Katarina Witt, but she couldn't beat Katarina Witt. Katarina, I mean, she just had, you know, the flow and the dress, and you could see that she was going to get the sixes. And the question was, could Liz beat Debbie Thomas? And Liz just went out there, and she pumped up that crowd and pumped us up. We were sitting right by the boards, remember? And Liz did the show of her life. She finished with a cowboy hat on, and she came rushing over, and she got her marks, and she was second. She jumped on my knee, and we did an interview right in my figure skating position. And we were all so excited because it was the moment of the games, except for one thing. I thought that Wilson and McCall skated the best performance of their life, and I thought they were the best performance in all of the Olympics in 1988. But they finished third to the Russians, first and second, you know, as they always have.
If you took skating and had a look at it, how would you describe the qualities about it that made it attractive to television?
What attracted me was, first of all, the intelligence and the personality and the tactical qualities of these skaters, the things they could do. And then you take them and put one person in center ice, who has had acrobatic training, has had, he's followed Karen Kane type, and all of those things, and put him in center ice, you put four or five cameras around, and one person to follow. Now this person also has the choice of the greatest music ever written. He could take from all the great composers, put the clips together, and then skate to it. So he was never out of camera, or he or she or they were never out of camera range, and it was so easy to follow, so easy to understand. The camera cuts could give you the close-up shots, and when they fall, you could do the replay and show what happened to them. And they fall. So there was nothing more natural for television than figure skating because of those reasons.
I know that at some level you're probably aware of this, my goodness, you've had so many tributes about the tremendous work you've done on behalf of figure skating. How does it make you feel to know that people regard you, not just in Canada, but probably around the world, as the person to bring figure skating to the forefront, to give it the high profile on television that it has today?
Well, I feel very good about that, and I appreciate such comments as that. But, you know, I really loved those kids. I loved those kids because they were coming up after hours every day, parents who couldn't afford it, and go back to their skating at night and go home at night later to do their homework, get up early in the morning and skate and skate and skate. And I really appreciated the amount of work that they put into it. And when you saw what they really did, you had to appreciate how good they were.
Johnny, on behalf of skating, I want to thank you for all of your tremendous contributions to the sport and to the athletes themselves. Thanks.
Thank you, Debbie.
Today on Retro, we'll have excerpts from both of Johnny's favorite competitions, and the first one is up right after this break. In 1973 at the World Championships, when triple jumps were still very rare in women's skating, there was a sense the event was being manipulated, the rumor being there was lots of meddling going on to try and affect the outcome of the women's competition. Canada's Karen Magnuson had been runner-up the previous year and at least on paper was considered the favorite in Bratislava, except that due to a huge sales campaign, a tidal wave of support had risen in favor of the American Janet Lin. Karen's free program to Spartacus has been shown on Ice Time before, but the short program with commentary by her coach Linda Brockman has rarely been seen.
When she started the compulsory program, the last thing I told her was about the beginning of the program and how to place it so that the double axel wouldn't be down into the barrier. And as soon as she started off and I saw her move her arms on the step down the side of the ring, I knew it was going to be good because I knew she was thinking. And as long as they're thinking, you know, they can do everything in the program. It's when they go blank and they can't remember what they're supposed to do and things go sort of soggy. And you can, I just could tell the minute she started it was going to work.
Karen Magnuson was the perfect competitor. The harder things got, the better she liked it. A confession she made this spring at the legendary night of skating in Toronto. She admitted 73 was tough on her, but felt she'd been protected from a lot of the gossip and rumor, a fact that helped her do her best.
And there was a lot of, just a lot of politics going on, half of which I didn't know anything about until many, many years later. Some of the stories would start surfacing about, you never knew about this, but, you know, this and this happened. And, you know, I guess I always just took competition in stride and enjoyed it so much that the more they said or anyone said I couldn't do something, it worked absolutely in the reverse. So anything that the camp of Janet Lynn did to try to dissuade me from doing what I loved doing out on the ice only turned against them and it made me stronger.
I was not there, but I remember Johnny Esau telling me millions of stories about how incredible you were and what a magical night it was.
Well, it was very exciting. And again, many years later, I found out that, I mean, they actually had to try to pay the Zamboni driver so that he could speed up the ice floods so that the satellite wouldn't diminish so that they could still film me and I would be on TV for the Canadian public because they were going to lose the satellite. And I mean, just funny stories like that and sort of political things that were going on. There was a sheet of paper that was given out to everybody at the competition except the people in the Canadian team saying who would be crowned the next queen of skating, of course, of which my name was left off, which I didn't know until like 20 years later. But, you know, these were all things that my coach, Linda Brockman, and my mom and team leaders like John Mackay kept out away from me so I could do my job out there. And they were buffers. I loved a good, strong competition. And there were a couple of competitions where I was supposedly the one to win, and it wasn't such a fight, and I did not skate well. And that was 1969 when Linda Carbonetto beat me.
1973 world champion Karen Magnuson, now living and teaching in Vancouver. In history, one of only three Canadian women, along with Barbara Ann Scott and Petra Burka, to bring the gold medal home to Canada. The history of women skating south of the border is considerably different and a whole bunch more prolific. One of those champions is up next. Focus today on retro, and one of the most famous was the girl with the wedge haircut, American world and Olympic champion Dorothy Hamill. There was something about Dorothy that captured the world's imagination. She had such life to her skating, and although she won the world gold medal only once, there have been few other skaters who've changed life off the ice as well as on. If you didn't have a Dorothy haircut, well, then at least you had to try the Hamill Camel, perfected by Dorothy at the end of this world championship performance in 76.
So she has to skate well. She opens up with a delay axel. Watch the delay in there. There it is, and then the turn. Her first difficult jump, a double axle right here. Oh, she's off to a good start. Second last year at the World Championships in Colorado Springs to Dan DeLue, who's also in this competition. She'll be skating last.
And she's currently second to Dorothy.
Dorothy was second to her after the compulsory figures, but had such an exceptional short program that she bypassed her to first, and she's going for that, trying to hold on to that first position right now. Here's a difficult combination. Two ollie jumps. She puts her arms above the head. In two. Nice split jump. Second split jump.
Three-time U.S. champion Dorothy Hamill. Making her rise to the world top 10 at the same time as Dot was a young free-skating marvel from Ottawa's Minto Club. A before and after of four-time Canadian champion Lynn Nightingale when we return. Welcome back to Retro's review of great women of the 70s and 80s. At the Canadian Championships in 73, Karen Magnuson would win the last of five national titles and witness the performance of 72 junior champion Lynn Nightingale, whose explosive jumping and joyous style popped her up into a third place finish her first year as a senior. Thanks to the CBC, here is Lynn's free program before any expectations of success.
Representing the Minto Skating Club in Ottawa, Lynn Nightingale.
Well, if anybody ever had a chance a big move and win herself a berth on a world team and goodness gracious knows what else, turned the whole thing topsy-turvy, it's this 16-year-old Lynn Nightingale. She won the compulsory free skating part of this competition. She can take over third place here from sixth. Here she gets right to third place. 2016. She won the Canadian Junior last year. She's from the Minto Club in Ottawa. Marilyn Thompson has really done a magnificent job with this youngster.
Until that moment, Lynn was just a promising youngster with a giant double axel. After Canadian, she was identified as a talent, and the system went into overdrive, producing and supporting what, in hindsight, was one of the greatest free skating talents in the world. 9 months later, at the First Skate Canada in Calgary, Lynn would become a champion and begin her competitive roller coaster ride, hating compulsory figures, and like in her 73 Skate Canada short program, loving to free skate.
Nightingale, a 17-year-old from Ottawa, who's been coached by Marilyn Thompson for the past 5 years. She has found herself in seventh position after the compulsory figure. She's really going to have to work now to get up that ladder.
And coming up, John, is one of the most difficult jumps in figure skating, especially for girls, a double axel, 2.5 revolutions. There it is. Very easily done by Lynn. Flying camel, her second move of the six compulsory moves that are required here in the short program. Earlier in the competition, the compulsory figures, out of the three figures, Lynn just literally goofed on one of them, and because of that fact, she's now trailing in seventh place. But with a performance like this, is sure to pick up. Nice delayed axel. You can see the movement, the motion of this girl when she's skating, how fast she covers the ice. There's her combination of jumps, double flip into a double loop. She's skating very well, John, and certainly should pick up.
two Lynn Nightingale programs, one before the moment fame struck, the other after. Lynn will help us all remember, first a commercial message and then a return to memories of Calgary in 73. In 1973, not only was Skate Canada the first event of its kind in North America, but it was the first taste of international success for young Lynn Nightingale. She was a bit in awe of some of her teammates, including Toller Cranston, but didn't let it inhibit her joy of skating. She was there to do a job. All she needed to find out was how.
First Skate Canada. I don't even know what year it was. 1973. The year before was the first year that I had made it to the World Championships. And Karen Magnuson won. So she had retired, and I was supposed to be, I don't know what you call that when you're the next one.
The heir apparent?
The heir apparent. So the first big competition was Skate Canada, and they had introduced it because there were a series of international competitions, not quite the same as they are today. So I, of course, was stellar in figures. There may have been 12 people in the competition, and I was probably 10th in figures. Maybe not that low, 9th. The next day I read in the paper, it said, Lynn Nightingale, oh no, it's 7th, because I do remember the headline. Lynn Nightingale, a disappointing 7th. And I thought, oh, I hate this. I don't want to play this game anymore. So that night, I was, of course, in the first group for the short program, and skated not bad.
Double flip, double loop, double axel.
Ooh,
big things, big things.
And then I went and took my skates off and went to the very, very highest seat in the Calgary...
The corral.
Corral. And put like a hex on everybody, that was in the next group, because I thought I was disappointing everybody, and the only way I'm going to get to first is they are terrible. So, and they did. They started dropping like flies. It was horrible. They'd go down once. They went down a second time. So that whole last group of skaters, I don't think anybody stood up. And I rocketed to like second or third position after the short program, and I thought, oh, that's much better. But you know what, afterwards I thought, no, I didn't really believe that it was me, but what a horrible way to win a competition. I mean, really what we want is everybody to skate their best, and the best person wins. So after that, I didn't do any more bad things. I always behaved myself, and I wanted everybody to do a good job.
And then you went on, was that kind of a turning point for you? I mean, you won Skate Canada. Then how did that...
You know what, I think the highlight of my career sort of ended in 1972. It was pretty much downhill from there.
It was not.
Well, I think so.
No, because you went on, what was your last year in world?
1977.
And where did you finish up?
I had pretty much a lock on seventh place for about 4 years in a row. And it was at that point I decided. I was 10th, I think, my first year, 6th the next year, and then I was 7th for, like, I don't know, 3 years. And the third year of being 7th, everybody had retired ahead of me. Like, I was probably supposed to be. By process of elimination, I should have been in the top three, and I was 7th again. I thought, you know what? What am I doing? This is so ridiculous. So I quit. Bye, see you later.
Except you were very high. In free skating, you were always coming back from poor figures.
Yes, always. Actually, I think my first year I was third in the short and fourth in the long. And I always did fairly well in the short program and like top three. And then, but I was always so low in figures. And then sometimes good long program, sometimes not. I mean, it got frustrating. After a while, I mean, you can't fight back. And I would change coaches and try to find the solution. Because I don't know that I was maybe not a talented figure skater, you know, surround and circle figure skaters. But I was a nervous wreck. I would be blind, absolutely blind. I couldn't concentrate. I couldn't focus. I couldn't sometimes see because my eyes would water up. And you know how that is when bright lights hit watery eyes and you're supposed to trace something? I don't think so. And so it was frustrating because I never really got better and I never got my nerves under control, and I don't know.
And yet you were always incredible in the free skate. Nerves were not a problem.
Never. But I liked it. I liked to skate. And I never really considered, when they took figures out, everybody said, oh, that's such a bad move. And I thought, like, I don't get it. Why is it a bad move? Because really, they were two different people that did figures well or free skating well.
What do you see the big difference between when you skated and people skating now?
I think that there's too much at stake now. That when skaters were allowed to make money, all of a sudden it became more of a job. And when we skated, there was absolutely no money. So the reasons and the motivation for you to skate was because you enjoyed it, because there was nothing at the end. No promise of great fortune, perhaps a little fame, but I don't know that fame drives people as much as money might motivate people. And I think it's fairly obvious when you watch skating today, they don't seem to have the same spirit, the same fun. It's a job, and it's a great job, but I think that would be the biggest difference between now and then. It sets people up for life, but I think it's sort of taken the joy out of it. Very few people skate with any kind of joy anymore. And when you do see them, boy, it's incredible.
Had it not been for figures and Lynn's nervousness about doing them, there is no doubt in my mind that Lynn would have become world champion. Up next on Retro, more talent from south of the border. We'll be right back. When Elaine Ziak won the world championships in 1982 by skating multiple eye-popping triples with the ease of singles, women's skating turned a corner. Never again could women expect to finish in the top 10 without them, and no one learned that fact better than the surprise winner at Worlds the next year in 83, Rosalind Sumners. Women's triples were anything but consistent. Everybody was trying them, and it was often like bowling for dollars out there. But with Roz's movie star good looks, she was the only skater to keep it together for both the short and the long. Her reward, a world title.
Seattle Skating Club. Her home is in Kirkland, Washington. She was junior champion of the world in 1980, and here she is about to become the champion of the ladies' world. She has a lot of class, a lot of poise. Watch the ease that she goes into and out of this double axel jump.
I can assure you that Rosalind's happy to get that triple out of the way because she was having problems with it in the warm-up. Here she goes into another triple, split jump, triple toe loop.
Ooh.
Hang on to that landing. Good for her.
Did you see the lean in the air there? But she was able to hold on.
It is quite an amazing success story for this young 18-year-old skater. She was sixth in the world last year.
another triple soft bow. She's skating beautifully. And all the moves between the jumps are important as well. She's putting a very strong program together here. Rosalind Sumners, now she was fourth in the short program, but she won the compulsory figures and her overall total didn't put her in the first place, and she hasn't even had the slightest wobble so far. John, I think she's only 1 minute away from the world title. Combination coming up, a couple of Wally jumps, hops into a double axel, another one beautifully done.
That's a jam-packed ending for a four-minute program.
And she gets a standing ovation, Rosalind Sumners.
Since that day in 1983, Rosalind Sumners has enjoyed a sparkling 16-year professional career, only announcing her retirement earlier this year. Up next on Retro, a performer who is still cooking and competing and who, as an amateur, provided me with one of my most thrilling moments in skating. Don't miss this one from the Calgary Olympics in just a moment. If there is one performance in my memory that signifies the very best of women's skating, and I agree big time with Johnny Esau, I have to look at the free programs from the 88 Calgary Olympics. I still get chills and goosebumps when I remember all the hype over the Battle of the Carmens and the totally glorious and unexpected way that Canadian Liz Manley took over the whole event. Everyone was so focused on Katarina Vitt and Debbie Thomas, nobody even bothered to notice there was another significantly better skater in the practice. Liz blew the roof off the building that night and surprised herself with a performance she had only ever dreamt about. You probably remember it too.
Well, 20,000 people here know that Elizabeth Manley's got a tough spot following Katarina, which she likes this position, and they're trying to get her pumped up to cheer her on, and look at, she looks like she's ready to come out of those starting blocks. She just goes out and does it.
This next one will be the telltale sign. It's the triple lutz.
Twice in warm-up, but she was perfect this time. Again!
And a beautiful double axel to end the first fast section of the program.
Elizabeth is in third place at this point.
And Peter Dunfield skating every one of those steps with her. Already she has done more triples than Katarina.
And could equal Midori.
This music, the Canadian Concerto.
Oh, keep going. her swan song.
Coming into the last combination, split jump. A double axel into the final spin. A perfect performance for Elizabeth Manley.
This is the one we were waiting for.
There were many doubters who said that Elizabeth probably would not get that special of a performance tonight at the Olympic Games.
Just when you think there's nothing new to get you revved up, along comes a moment like Liz Manley's, and it knocks you out and turns the sport around. Talk about the right thing at the right time. That's one of the things that makes me so gaga over the sport. You study it, you study the players, you know their personalities, their strengths, and their weaknesses. On paper, you can predict a majority of the results. But something else is in there that you can never predict or estimate or even understand, and that's the heart of the athlete. For women competing today, the heart of their sport has been ripped out, I think. Everybody criticizing the quality and emphasizing the number of falls and the lack of consistent triple jumps. Well, no wonder. Number one, since the ISU couldn't make a definitive or long-term decision about triple jumps for women, they've had no clear direction. Number two, the situation is drowning in mixed messages. If you want triples, all restrictions must be removed. Instead of having age requirements that are keeping jumpers out of the event and protecting skaters that should have probably retired a long time ago, open it up and let the development of the sport happen naturally. That's what I think today. Our next retro is a juicy one featuring the 1980 World Championships and one of the most fascinating personal stories from Canadian skating history, the life and times of Tracy Wainman, who nearly 20 years later is still dealing with the fallout of her childhood success. Tracy will join us right here in the studio, and I hope you will too. That's next on Retro Ice Time. Bye for today.